This is Witching Hour Dark Pumpkin Beer. What is this? Multi-seasonal spicy shadowy. Ooh. Pair with raking and daylight saving time from Torque Brewery in Winnipeg. I'm not sure even whether it's an ale or a stout or a porter. I think it's just a dark ale. But yeah, seems interesting, and everything's pumpkin-y this time of year, so why not? That's not bad. It's a good kind of a multi-flavor, and it's not actually pumpkin-flavored. It's flavored like the spices that you typically put in a pumpkin pie, just like all these other pumpkin spice things that are on the market. But they've kept it subtle, so I can finish this. Not like I wasn't going to anyway, but you know. Point of the video today. I was at the dollar store, and I found this plug-in wireless doorbell with two transmitters and the one base station / noisemaker unit for $4, which is shockingly cheap. For like two little radio transmitter modules, I'm gonna guess that they are those, hang on. So yeah, I'm gonna guess that they're either going to be something similar to the NRF24LL1 or to these cheap 433 meg RF transmitter receiver units. That's a guess. It doesn't say anything on it about the frequency, just that it's FCC and Industry Canada certified. Button batteries are installed, mount in the desired location, plug door chime into any 120 volt AC electrical within the operating range, which is up to 150 feet. There are 32 selectable codes to block interference from outside signals. Cool. So that sounds like it's got channels like these NRF units do, or data pipes, really. But we'll see. It doesn't say anything about frequency. Oh, man. I've broken my first scalpel blade. That's not performance. Fortunately, I have my good old trusty X-Acto that I've been using for years to finish the job. Hear that noise? That is my sump pump. It's been raining and snowing stupidly for a long time around here, and the ground is saturated with water around the house, so the sump pump keeps going off. I'll try and not let it interfere too badly. Okay, so we have a door chime, we have two buttons, we have 4 3-volt lithium batteries installed. So I assume those batteries are going to be inside these guys. A couple of adhesive pads and a couple of screws. Okay, how do we get into this? Looks like there's a little poke me hole there. Those are... Oh, okay. There's a little button there, and then the main button. The main button's kind of rubbery feel. Can you see that sort of rubbery texture on there? And then there's this little slightly subtle button up there, which I assume is for pairing or programming or something. I'm guessing you just push there and open he comes. Yeah. All right, so we do have... Ooh, it's even a Sony-branded CR2032. And these things are branded Thomas and Betts inside, which is a legitimate manufacturer of electrical goods. Or at least the name is legitimate anyways. Can I pop this apart further without breaking it beyond use? Should I even try? Should I maybe see if it works first? See what the manual says. Okay, so that's a mount that you just pop that off. Okay. That's not really a surprise. To test, plug the chime receiver into any standard household outlet. Push the button. It should make noise. Okay, let's try that. One standard cheap extension cord. That's plugged in. Volume, high, medium, and low. Let's leave it on high for now. So. Really? What about the other one? Okay. That's not allowed in Canada. I'll have to figure out what these other ones are. Okay. Right. Uh-huh. Seasonal. Oh, I suppose I could have just read it off the back here. Dong, ding, dong. Westminster Chime, Star Spangled Banner, Hail, Hail, Gings All Here, Jingle Bells, Auld Lang Syne, Dixie, which should be the next one in the sequence. Next, dong. That's only ding dong. Slightly different ding dong. That's Westminster. Okay, so there's the eight songs that it can do. And each one, yeah, each one is slightly different. So you can have a front door and a back door, but they don't interrupt. So at least you know who's at the front door and who's at the back door. I guess that's something to start with. What else do we have here? Privacy codes, battery replacement, privacy codes, yeah. Not necessary, unplug, remove screw, use nail clipper to cut one or more of the jumper wires. Okay. They want you to take the cover off the back. Awesome, I can do that. Okay, so there's jumper wires there, A, B, C, D, E, they're labeled. So there's jumper wires in the back of there. There's jumper wires in the back of here that are also labeled A, B, C, D, E. I'm going to guess the other one. So you got five different, wait a minute, do you have five different codes or, oh no, one or more, okay. We'll dive a little bit deeper into this guy. One screw, and apart it comes. So we have a speaker. That's not a surprise. And we have this stuff. And we have a wire antenna wrapped around the back and just stuck on with some kind of goop. Okay, so what do we have here? Aha, there's the radio board. There's the programming jumpers. Is this looking suspiciously like a capacitive dropper? Sure does to me. And then we got, got some RF components up here. Tunable inductor, a bunch of small little capacitors, 104, and some smaller guys there. And that's all potting wax. I haven't seen that in a modern product in a long time. That was like the old walkie-talkies used to get back when I was a kid, where all the RF components are covered with that stuff to keep them from vibrating around. But, yeah, I don't see it very much anymore. So, all these capacitors and the inductor, transistor there. So this will be sort of the RF preamplifier kind of section, and then feeding into the board. Now, the board is, what does it say on there? GHTCOB2.PCB. Right. Judging by its proximity to the speaker wires, which are, where are you guys? That one and that one, which connect directly to it. So that will probably be the noise. Oh, actually, no. It's also got connections to these programming jumpers as well. So those programming jumpers, they're not going to be controlling RF. They're going to be controlling the data on the RF or the signaling. So this has probably got receives the demodulated information, or at least downconverted probably from the RF section here, and does the or checks to see if it's supposed to be receiving from that the data burst, and then makes the noises. Probably one is doing, one of these blobs is doing the processor, for lack of a better word, and one of them is doing the sound, is my guess. Okay, but there's no indication as to what frequency is going on in here, sadly. So what do we have here? There and there, that is a 0.1 microfarad. That's interference suppression. That's across there. Okay, that's going to there. That's going through this guy. 2U2K, 250 volt capacitor. In series, that's coming out to there. Couple diodes. Yeah, that's what's going on here. This is an inductor, a capacitor dropper type power supply. But yeah, so that's probably what's going on there. Let's see if we can get inside one of these now. Oh, that wasn't too bad. Coin cells falling out. And I'm actually impressed that they're using Sony branded coin cells as well. And they could have just been using one Hung Lo brand, right? And again, not much to see here. Here is the antenna. Antenna comes from here and loops around. This is just mechanical holding and ends there. It even says antenna. Anyway, again, an adjustable inductor there for tuning, potting wax to hold it in place. Flux residue all over the back here. It's kind of messy. There is the trigger push button. There is the change your tune push button. And the interesting bit is hidden in a blob. Well, that's modern electronics for you, isn't it? It doesn't let you see what the secrets are under the hood. So to find out more information about this thing, I'm going to go and check its FCC ID or Industry Canada ID, because every RF device has to be registered with the authorities, proving that it's capable of not interfering with other things, operating on its own channel, and capable of receiving interference from other things without malfunctioning and being goofy and weird. So there's various testing and stuff done, and that testing is recorded at the various government agencies under and filed under these registration numbers. So weirdly, searching around on the FCC's website didn't find it. However, Industry Canada search did take me to an FCC webpage that I couldn't find through the FCC's own webpage, which does have the thing, and it's got a copy of the entire manual in it. And then what else we got here? Then it shows the actual frequency that it runs on, which is kind of handy. That's what I was sort of looking for. So it's running in the 315 megahertz band, so somewhere between 267 and 322. And here on that same FCC ID website is exactly what we got in front of us on the workbench. There's the circuit board. That's a much cleaner example than the one that I've got. The one that I've got, as you saw earlier, has all kinds of flux and schmoo on it. Yeah, and there's those jumpers. Does mine have that transistor on it? It doesn't. it's a slightly different version. I'll have to check the dates on the circuit board as well. This one is from 2006. Mine's from 2010. Okay. What else is... So this thing's been around for a while, obviously, in different versions. And there's no pictures of the guts of the receiver, but that doesn't matter because we just saw that. Okay, rolling in the new test equipment. Well, not new, but, you know, what wasn't here before. So I have my SDR, just the cheap SDR dongle, the cheapest one you can find on eBay, with its antenna sitting down here right beside the doorbell pushy button. I have my RF analyzer software. RF analyzer 1.3, for those who wish to play along at home. I've got my RF analyzer software running, and I've got it pretty close, just below 315, because I've been messing around before I started the camera. And when I push the button, there's the little burst of RF that makes it happen. Looks like it sends it two or three times. One, two, three. Can I zoom in on the waterfall? I can't really. But it sort of looks like there's three distinct bursts in there. And you sort of see them popping up there too. Spread it out just a little bit, zoom in on it. But you notice this guy's centered pretty close to 314.65. 0.6. It wanders around a little bit, which isn't that surprising with the tuning coils being just kind of loose and rough. And there's no crystal. It's just RC circuits that are controlling the frequency of it. So it wanders a little bit, but that's okay because this is probably not that precise a receiver anyway. So, and it looks like each time it does jump a little bit too. It starts down here at 314.55, and then the next two or three bursts are at 314.6. So that's kind of interesting. I'd like to look at this closer on my scope. Unfortunately, my scope, as awesome as it is, maxes out at 300 meg, and the cheap probes that I've got are just 100 meg rated, so I can't see it on there, unfortunately. But that's interesting. Well, that would be interesting to play with, except for I don't have any 315 meg RF modules. I'm going to have to go scouring around on eBay and see if I can find any that will play in this frequency, because maybe we can either use these guys. If we can decode them, maybe we can use these guys to trigger an Arduino to do something. Or maybe their Arduino can trigger the noisemaker. Might be interesting to play with at some time in the future. Unfortunately, I think that's about all I can do with this thing today. It's kind of cool to see what you can get at the dollar store for $4, though. And from a reputable brand name, too. I have to assume these are an overstock or something that they bought. I can't imagine why else they would have that. So I did a little bit of searching around just to see what this thing is worth, and wow, the one button version of it from Ye Olde Canadian Tire, $43, but it's discontinued. So I guess that discontinued explains why it's at the dollar store, doesn't it? How about eBay? That's pretty much it again, except for that's the one button version, $30. There's another one, $19 plus 14 shipping. Seriously, guys? And nobody seems to be selling the two button version. Yeah, I must have got the deluxe one from my dollar store from four whole dollars. Well, I hope you found that slightly interesting. I always enjoy taking apart these things just to see what's going on inside them. And it's kind of cool to me anyway, to see this relatively old school RF circuitry in here. Like I said earlier, it reminds me kind of those walkie-talkies that I used to get way back in the late 70s, early 80s. Especially that potting wax, that's kind of cool. Well, not really potting. It's more just to anchor everything in place so that those the tuning slugs don't change. Anyway, I found that interesting. Hope you did too. Thanks for watching. Comments, questions, as usual, down below. And I will talk to you later.